What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous videos of this series, we started by giving an overview about graphs in the Graphs Fundamentals video, followed by several trees videos. Then recently, we tackled one of the two most popular graph traversal techniques in our breadth-first search algorithm video. Today, and to continue on this topic, we are going to detail and implement the depth-first search traversal algorithm. So, similarly to breadth-first search, the depth-first search algorithm traverses a graph by visiting every vertex exactly once in a well-defined manner. This means that initially, all the vertices of the graph are marked as not visited, and as soon as we hit a vertex, we set it to be visited. Now, contrary to the BFS algorithm, which traverses the graph level by level, the DFS algorithm will go as far as it can down a given path, then backtracks until it finds another unexplored path and visits it. Take this graph as an example, which is the same one we had in our BFS algorithm video. To traverse it using DFS, you need to first pick a starting vertex, that's our entry point. Then, because we just acknowledged this vertex, we mark it as visited. What we have to do now is start exploring the first neighbor of this vertex and its neighbors all the way down. So, in this example, the next vertex we visit is 1, then 3. Now, because 3 has no unvisited neighbors, we backtrack to the closest parent with unvisited neighbors, and in our case, it is vertex 1. Then we visit its next neighbor, which is 4, and go all the way down till we reach a vertex with no neighbors, that's vertex 2 in our case. We then backtrack to 4 and visit 6, and it's the closest unexplored path. Here, based on the algorithm we've been portraying, we should continue to vertex 0, as it is the neighbor of 6. However, 0 was already visited, therefore we consider that 6 has no more neighbors. So we backtrack all the way to vertex 1 and visit the last vertex, 5. And with this ends our graph traversal. Now, in our breadth-first search video, we associated the BST algorithm with the queue data structure. However, you can clearly see that what we are doing has nothing to do with the first-in, first-out structure, but rather a last-in, first-out structure. The starting vertex we gave to the algorithm at the beginning still had to be checked for unvisited vertices till the last operation, till the last vertex. And we can clearly see that because the last vertex that was traversed earlier was a direct neighbor of our root. This means that the DFS algorithm is somehow related to the stack data structure. Let's try to prove this by traversing the same graph once more and make use of a stack at the same time. So, the first thing we need to do is add the starting vertex to this stack. Then, because the stack isn't empty now, we pop the top vertex from it, mark it as visited, and add the neighbors of the vertex we just popped to the stack. Now, these three actions, popping from the stack, marking what we popped as visited, and adding the neighbors of non-visited vertices to the stack, are repeated until the stack is empty and the graph is considered traversed. But wait! The output we just got isn't exactly similar to the previous one, even though it is the same graph and we executed the same exact flow of logic. You see, the difference is that in this stack, we added all the neighbors at once. Hence, the top neighbor vertex that the algorithm had to pop and start with was the last one. Whereas, in the first example we gave, we acted on each vertex individually, and as soon as we visited a particular vertex, we explored its branch. I know this might be a little confusing, that's why let's proceed with the implementation, in which I guarantee that things will be way clearer. Let's start by creating the node or vertex class. This class will store the data, a Boolean field to keep track of whether this vertex was visited or not, and a list of its neighbor vertices. As usual, we also made sure that our class is generic enough. This will allow us to store any kind of object in the graph. The annotations you see are Lombok annotations that will generate setters, getters, a toString method, and many others. If you have no idea what these are, feel free to take a look at our Lombok annotations video, linked down below in the description. Now, concerning the depth first search class, this one will only house the implementation of the traverse method, which we are now going to implement. In the example we just saw, we started by adding the starting vertex to the stack we had. That is exactly what we are going to do here. First, we create the stack in question, and then we add the vertex passed by the user to the stack. Now, while the stack we just created isn't empty, we have to pop the top element or vertex of this stack. Then, as soon as this element is popped, we mark it as visited. We print it out or do whatever we want to do with it. Then finally, we have to push all of its neighbors to the same stack to allow the while loop to repeat the same logic on all these vertices. Now, while this implementation may work on a few graphs, it won't work on all of them, as it is missing a crucial part, which I actually mentioned before, and it is cycles. Take the same graph we had as an example. If we apply the current implementation on this graph, what will happen is that these two vertices will keep on adding each other to the stack endlessly, triggering an infinite while loop. To fix this, and as I previously mentioned, we need to execute this logic and add to the stack the neighbors of non-visited vertices only. This was done here using the if statement you see in front of you. With this, the implementation of the depth-first search algorithm is now complete. And if you go ahead and test it by creating the vertex objects that represent the same graph we've been working with and set their corresponding neighbors, you will see that the output will be exactly the same as the one we got when we made use of the stack in our previous example. But how can we get the very first results we got right at the beginning of the video? How can we preserve the ordering of the neighbors of our vertices? You see, what is actually happening is that the order of the vertices is being reversed, as we already mentioned. And one way to obtain the very first output using this implementation is to reverse the list of neighbors before pushing it onto the stack. This was done here using the collections.reverse method. Another way to do it is to use recursion. When implemented recursively, the DFS algorithm will make use of the stack memory to traverse the vertices, and the stack will mark the vertex as visited as soon as it is added onto the stack. To implement this algorithm recursively, what you have to do is extract the logic you wrote inside the while loop to a new method, in our case the visited setter and the printing stuff mainly. Also, we can now get rid of everything related to pushing and popping and of the stack itself, as now all of these operations are being handled automatically for us by the memory. The two remaining lines of code are adding the neighbors and checking if each is visited. Let's move them to the newly created method. And for each unvisited neighbor, what we are going to do is call the same recursive method. You can also simplify this by extracting intermediate calls into stream operations. And voila, the DFS algorithm implemented recursively. If you go ahead now and run this code on the same main class we had, the output will preserve the order of the vertices' neighbors. Okay, before ending the video, I want to mention that both of these implementations, the iterative and the recursive, are valid DFS implementations. A DFS does not specify which node you should see first, and it is usually not important because the order between edges is not defined. They only differ by the way which you handle each vertex's children. In the iterative approach, you first insert all the elements into the stack and then handle the head of the stack, which is the last node inserted. Thus, the first node you handle is the last child. In the recursive approach, you handle each node when you see it. Thus, the first node you handle is the first child. And as we saw together, to make the iterative DFS yield the same result as the recursive one, you need to add the elements to the stack in reverse order. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.